So Roshan was born in Qatar. He's an Indian origin gentleman, born and educated in Qatar, and then came back to Mumbai and studied at IIT. And now he's ventured into his third business enterprise. So the initial two businesses that you started, you valued it and you exited those businesses.
Yeah, I mean, I reached a stage of life where I was a young person and was offered an exit. So at that stage of my life where, you know, I had just gotten married and, you know, wanted to chill out for a little while, etc. And I also felt at that point of time the telecom business, which I was in, was probably at the peak of its boom.
So when you value a company and when you plan an exit, what is the calculation that you did? Did you think that you're exiting for a lesser value? Do you think after exiting that you should have waited longer and got a better deal? What was the thoughts that processed after you did the transaction?
So when you do the transaction, you always feel you're getting a bad deal. It's only in hindsight that you feel that, oh, okay, the market actually, you know, if I look at Airtel, for instance, from when I exited now, Airtel's not doing very well. So in hindsight, probably it's the right time to I exited. But when you're doing the transaction, you always feel, oh, okay, I'm actually going to, my stake could probably be worth a lot more if I hold on, et cetera, et cetera.
And what was your pitch when you exited? What was your pitch to the investors or to the buyers?
The pitch was, okay, so it was a unique situation where along with me, the large shareholder was a private equity fund. And the business was capital intensive, which means that we were in the business of distributing telecom currency. And the nature of the business is such that you buy currency from the operators and then you sell it to the shopkeeper. And this is a business which is, at when I exited the business, is about 36,000 crores in India a month business. That's the kind of volume of the business, and you work at very small percentages. So it was a business that when I was an equity shareholder, it was, I felt it would take a lot more capital. And so I felt that, you know, I don't want to be in this business where I may be an electronic, like a PTM, but effectively I am somebody else's agent. I'm distributing for Airtel and Tata Sky and, you know, O2 and all of those guys. And so I felt that I want to create my own brand and I want to be on the other side. So I want to be where other people are my distributors and they are putting in capital to distribute me as opposed to me putting in capital to distribute them. And
what was the gap time? After you exited, when did you get, what triggered the conceptualization and creation of Tripvillas? And what was the gap time between your exit and the new entity?
So when I exited, I had no plan. I kind of just took, I was recently married. Me and my wife decided we'll take a year to just, you know, just chill out, relax, buy a house, do the interiors, you know, do more creative things for some time. I bumped into, at a conference in the, like an exhibition, I don't know if many people know this, is South by Southwest. In Texas, I bumped into a gentleman called Craig Newmark, who was the founder of Craigslist. And it was very inspiring to hear his story because he runs the world's largest free website at that point of time. Yesterday, they've announced that his company, which he owns 100% of, makes $1 billion. Yesterday, they announced that they make $1 billion in revenue and $950 million in profit every year. So this is the power of a free website in that era. And I was very inspired when I met him and I said, okay, why don't I just, you know, learn how to program? I was a technical person by training. And it was many years since I'd been programming. So I said, let me learn how to program. Let me build a simple website. And when I did that, I said, let me do a free website where people who own holiday homes can come and register, etc. So the genesis was a free website. What happened was after a little while.
How did you identify the gap in the market that, you know, you will be able to make vacation homes into a remunerative activity?
No, I didn't. I didn't do that. So to be very honest, Tripvillas was incorporated 18 months after I started the website. So the first 18 months
was a free
website.
So was it an afterthought?
It was an afterthought. It was serendipity. To give you an idea of what happened, a friend of mine, I'm not sure if many people here know, but Balu Nair, who used to be with Vodafone in Bombay, his wife was a journalist with Rediff.com. And she, I think it was early days of Facebook, so she saw Balu looking at this, what is this website that Roshan has started on, you know, as a free service. And she wrote an article about us on Rediff. The website became very popular. And then Thomas Cook called us. So Thomas Cook, some junior guy at Thomas Cook, I think they found my number somehow. And he called us up and said that, you know, hey, look, you know, this is, we want to book this villa. And which is, we had about 30, 40 villas on the website. And he said, what commission will you give us? And we were a free service, so we never had a commission ourselves. So on the phone, I was like, okay, we'll give you a 10% commission because what, I mean, you know, this 10% is obvious. So then we said, okay, now how do we give him a 10% commission? So we just went out and wrote an email to the 20, 30 owners who were registered saying that we are going to charge you a 20% commission, but Thomas Cook is going to sell for us. So you'll get, and we're going to give them, you know.
So you immediately started collaborative commerce.
Yeah, so
immediately. And you started partnering with players who are bigger than you and who had a market share.
We got the genesis, but we didn't actually. So we got this idea from Thomas Cook and you know, I was from a business which was the telecommunications business, and in telecommunications we have a unique way of selling. So we have three conferences across the globe, one in the US, one in Hong Kong, and one in Madrid. And if you sell a telecom product, you exhibit at the exhibition. So I only knew that way of selling. So when we were going to launch this travel product, I said, okay, what's the big travel exhibition in India? And there was an exhibition that coincidentally was happening in Bombay about 15 days after, you know, the idea came to us. It was an exhibition called TTF, which was happening at BKC or somewhere like that. So we said that, okay, let's test this. Let's put up a stall at TTF. And let's say how many travel agents want to be our agents and want to sell these 100 villas, you know, for us. And we ended up getting, you know, about 1,000 travel agents who signed up to be agents within that 24 hours when we put up that stall.
So that propelled your first step.
Yes, but it also scared us. So it, because we had no staff, I was, you know, it was me only, and you know, one other person who was like a fugitive who was part of my company. Because when I left my earlier company, there was one person who was a programmer who was perceived to be very close to me, and so when I exited, he also had to exit that company, you know.
So when a company like Airbnb came in, so yeah, they are typically not operators, they are basically aggregators.
Correct.
Whereas Tripvillas is not a aggregator, it is an operator. It is an aggregator plus an operator.
Correct.
How did you integrate that model into yours, Tripvillas? And did you realize that Tripvillas is not only technology, but you also need to have a lot of offline support?
Yeah.
So did you anticipate the kind of involvement that would be needed to support the online with the offline, and were you able to match with the demand that was growing?
Yes and no. So we didn't anticipate how deep we would go. So what we anticipated was, so we had always a lot of owners registering on the website. We had a lot of owners who would always tell us that, you know, I have this home, but I can't manage it. So we anticipated that we would set up sort of branch offices. So like, you know, like a small office in, let's say, Phuket on the beach, and owners could come to the office and then give us the keys, and then people could come to that office and take the keys from us, etc. We did not anticipate that suddenly organized real estate would happen in holiday homes. Because when we started the business, it was still, I would say, my parents' generation of holiday homes, where the typical Asian family would buy a plot of land and they would build a custom home on that plot of land, maybe immediately after a few years. But what happened, which actually, you know, sort of grew our business significantly, was you had organized real estate development happening. So you had, like, you know, real estate developers who were mainstream Thai developers, Indonesian developers, Indian developers, etc., who said that, no, we will launch holiday home projects. And then they started saying that, okay, you know, we want someone who will be a management partner. For us, it became less chaotic. So it became, you know, instead of managing, you know, putting an office in the main market in Bali or main on the beach in Phuket and managing one villa 1 kilometer away, another villa 2 kilometers away, etc., it became managing a complex with 150, 200, 300 units in one complex with a clubhouse, a swimming pool, a spa, a restaurant within that community. So it became, we anticipated it, but not to this scale and not to this level of organization.
So government of Singapore is a very interesting government, one of the most powerful and the most well-organized governments in the world, very effective and very efficient. And you were successful in bringing investments from the government of Singapore into your entity, into your company. Yeah. What is that triggered them to be a part of Tripvillas? Did you, what macro picture did you explain to them?
So they have a thesis that, you know, they want sort of businesses which are key businesses in any particular vertical to be headquartered in Singapore. So their thesis was travel is big. You know, all the other major travel companies like Booking, Expedia, they are all headquartered in Asia. And this, which is vacation real estate and vacation home rentals, and is a new category, you know, in travel accommodation, which means that, you know, among the various places that you can stay, this is opening up a new category, and they felt that this business, we should have it headquartered in Singapore. And that was essentially the starting of the dialogue with them. And then, you know, of course, you know, for them to really lend credibility to the business, the best way for them to do that is to take an equity stake. Because it kind of, I mean, it would be different if, let's say, it's the Prime Minister's office of Sudan who's your, or, you know, some other country which is your shareholder. But in the Southeast Asian region where we started off, the government of Singapore brings credibility with Indonesian tourism, with Thai tourism, it's Philippine tourism.
What is the kind of support that gets extended when a Singapore government invests into a company?
Various
do
things.
They give you handholding in multiple countries through official channels?
Yes, they do. So they have very active trade promotion bodies. So to give you an example, when we were setting up our office in Manila, they first, of course, encouraged us to set up the office. Secondly, they paid for, including small things, they paid for like the recruitment agency's charges to hire the first few employees. They paid for the business center space for our team to go there and conduct interviews, hotel, accommodation, because they do small things like this, which is just saying that, okay, don't even think about setting up in Manila, we'll pay for all the small costs for you to go and explore the market.
Who paid this? Singapore government?
Singapore government, yeah, they did.
What is the shortest route for making Singapore government invest into our companies?
So I think first thing is an appreciation that there is the Indian version of a Babu sitting there. So you have to understand that there is a bureaucrat who's sitting there, who has got a KRA and reporting. And what is his objective with investing in companies? And his objective typically with any government, whether it's Singapore or Austria or Switzerland, is to say that, okay, can we create jobs? Can we move a company and get intellectual property, which is then going to be resident in Singapore? And so there are these five or six parameters. And as long as you understand that, and then you know what to negotiate on, and you know what will make him look good. So you know what will drive him to say that, okay, we will invest in this company, because you know he has got an Excel sheet somewhere where he needs to fill this in.
In India, because of concepts like Airbnb and Tripvillas, suddenly residence has become the new commercial. Where a home buyers for a vacation home, he buys a residential property on a residential loan, on a residential tenure, at a residential rate of interest, and gives it to somebody like Airbnb, or gives it to somebody like Tripvillas, and starts generating commercial income. Have you realized the value of this strength in a country like India?
Yeah, we are great believers in it. Because we believe that commercial real estate, by its nature, can only be accessed by higher net worth individuals. And commercial real estate is by its nature risky, because the concept of having an office today is going away. I'm sure you would have seen the trends towards co-working and lots of shared office utilization.
So you'll be leveraging this advantage where the Indian government has opened up where residential houses can be utilized for bed and breakfast kind of a license.
Correct. So in Maharashtra, you have that scheme.
Yes. Yeah. So the government is supporting and cooperating purely to develop tourism in this country.
Yes.
So that's absolutely a fantastic launch pad for a company like Tripvillas. But what happens is, once the regulations smoothen up, right, it is a level playing field for all the companies. How do you plan to take on new companies like Oyo, who are extremely well-funded and who are really spoiling the, not spoiling, it is their strategy, really penetrating the market very aggressively by giving great lollipops?
So we are very clear, for any vibrant market, there needs to be many players. Now the question is, what is the, on that podium where there'll be number one, number two, number three, etc., where do we want to be? And so we want to be, you know, the marquee brand. And we may tomorrow say that, you know, by being that marquee brand, we may have multiple brands at different segments. But essentially, we feel that we want to be the Marriott or the Accor or the organized player managing holiday homes and, you know, being present in multiple segments there. So Oyo is in the budget segment. Today, they may launch a premium brand to manage higher-end vacation homes. We may launch a budget brand, but it's debatable whether it's possible, because in every location you will not have only one building. So it's natural that, you know, real estate is the nature of the industry such that you will have in Lonavala five nice complexes, and obviously we cannot have our logo on five complexes.
So Tripvillas is a basically service sector. When people book in and come in, they will also share their experiences. How do you make sure that the experience of every customer who books in through Tripvillas is satisfied to the T? Of course, in service sector, you can't satisfy 100% of the people 100% of
first
the times.
You set
How do you measure right? that? How do you measure that?
So the way that you measure is repeat bookings. So this is the clear metric where, you know, if a person is happy, then he will refer other customers, etc. But I think what we have also realized is you want to set the expectation right, because we have had, in the early days, a lot of people who came in and said that, oh, but this is should be like a hotel. And so we want to be very clear that this is not a hotel experience. It's superior and it's inferior in certain ways. And we want to be clear upfront about that. Secondly, in these managed communities, we offer a service layer which makes it very, very close to a hotel. So what I mean by that is we have a clubhouse, we have a restaurant, we have a buffet, we have many cases a spa and things like that. So it's really not, you're not leaving out too much by going from a hotel to one of our
places. As an entrepreneur, what is your core focus areas on the enterprise operations? Where do you focus more on? And what do you think will need more improvement in the coming days?
So I, by nature, so I have what I have historically focused on and what I intend to focus on going forward. So I have historically focused on in the business, on the technology, on the operations, on the overall strategic planning. So if I was an employee of yours, you typically say that, okay, Roshan is doing strategic planning. He's continuously looking at Excel sheets and he's doing a business modeling, etc. What for the past 1 year, I have tried more and more to move towards being more of a people manager or a people inspirer and getting that, you know, that country team. So to enable, because it's, I found it challenging to kind of have to do everything myself or the buck stopping at me.
And how do you map your competition?
Mapping our competition, see, we have competition which is local. So the main source of competition is the guy who does a really good job managing villas in Bali. This is the key competition. And we can never do as good a job as that guy in Kuta Beach or in Phuket, etc. Because he just knows that market so well. So for us, the question is that, you know, we will never be able to do as good a job as that really local player. So what can we do as a corporate or a larger entity which offers a uniformity of service? So we cannot be the boutique hotel, which is like what you would see sometimes in India. But our aspiration is to be the Marriott or the, which gives you a certain level of guaranteed service, gives you a certain guarantee or meets your expectation or exceeds that expectation, and then gives you certain network effects like loyalty and those kind of programs.
You know? How do you map your growth? How do you plan that this year, this is what I need to grow? So does your growth happen on the response that you automatically get through in terms of villa owners or unit owners or in terms of sales? Or you have a structured way that this year, this is the growth that we need to achieve, and these are the tools which are planned to make them achieve?
So there is a base level of growth, which is what we call standing still growth, which means that, you know, no new properties coming into the system. This is the growth that we generally focus on in terms of product innovation, improvement in process, technology, etc. In addition to this, we have grown typically 3 times, 4 times every year on the back of new communities, which means that we have signed large new deals and that causes big growth. So that is chunky, which means that, you know, let's say for instance, if we have like last year in India, in the whole year we had signed 1,000 properties. Towards the end, I think in November, we launched a 1,800 apartment community called Adora di Goa with Purvankara in Goa, which sold out on one in the first day. So it was a record in Indian real estate, and, you know, so we could not have anticipated that, you know, we would launch that development, which would sell out the same day, and you know, we would add from 1,000 properties in India to 1,800 additional properties.
So does this kind of results excite you also to become a developer in a country like India?
No, it doesn't, because...
because if Purvankara can sell it in 24 hours on the promise of Tripvillas as a revenue model, then don't you suddenly in the middle of the night feel that, oh, this has happened because of me, I can become a builder?
No, I think for us, we are clear that we are not in the initial transaction. We are in the ongoing management of these assets and the long-term compounding of the number of assets under our management. That is our perception of our business.
Is this because of valuation game that you're playing in your mind?
Not really. It is a lesser risk business and lesser reputation risk business, because we perceive that.
But wouldn't it be that more number of rooms and more number of units will add more to the valuation and you can get a better price for the stock?
Not. I mean, it's depending. It's a dual-edged sword, right? So if just by virtue. So, for instance, in India, the largest number of rooms, you know, is not necessarily the most profitable company, is not the company that's doing the best on the stock exchange. So if you see today in India, like let's say the listed players, you leave aside Oberoi and Taj, Leela is worth close to nothing. I think you have the next largest, which but is Sarovar.
They own the assets for which the loans that they have taken, they are not able to service that. In Tripvillas' case, you're like Uber. You don't own it and you still earn from it.
No, but we have the operating costs of that asset. What that means is that, you know, that even though we have not paid to buy, you know, the 700 apartment complex, we still have to spend on the upkeep of that asset and generation of the yield. It means that, you know, it's not that we have to spend a lot, but there is still a cost. So we will be very careful about, should we take this building in Kalangut, or should we take this building in Kalangut, or should we take this building in Kunur, or should we take this building in Kunur? So we go to that level. Yeah.
How quick are you to understand the local market challenges or the local market culture? Being an online model and into the vacation homes, you're into multiple countries, and multiple countries have got multiple flavors of operations. So which do you find the most convenient to operate and revenue yielding compared to the same amount of efforts that you put in some other country? What would you compare it to in India, which is a better market, and why?
So in India, I think the inspiration has to come from Sri Lanka. Because when I look at what is a market that's very similar to India in terms of culture, geography, the capital power, you know, Sri Lanka is lower than India in all those metrics. At the same time, it performs much better. This is because in Sri Lanka, for instance, you can get planning permissions easily. You can build on the beach. You can you have good roads. You have you know, a more island culture, which is more familiar for tourism, et cetera, et cetera. So I would say from India, looking outwards, I would say Sri Lanka is a great market.
How do you map the productivity of your profitability? Like, for example, for the same amount of efforts in India, I make an X value. In Singapore, I make X plus Y. In Bali, I make X plus Y plus Z. So do you map that? And do you plan your growth accordingly? Like a country which is giving you more bookings and more efficiency of operations needs to be expanded more. Do you strategize that scientifically?
Yeah, we do. So we are very clear about yield driving our entry into a new market. What I mean by that is that we would not go into Bangkok. When we look at Italy, or let's say if you take European, and we decided, okay, we want to enter Europe, we decided to look at which country in Europe we should enter. And, you know, a lot of people came with lots of esoteric ideas, but we ultimately chose Italy for our first European office. And that's linked to, of course, Italy being, you know, the first port of call for a well-traveled person for sport, religion, art, culture, food, wine, et cetera, et cetera. But also goes towards Italy's real estate prices being at an all-time low and correspondingly yield being very high. So we are very clear that when we want to enter a market, we want to have yield working in our favor so that the people who are investing into properties and giving them under management to us, they can't lose to a certain extent. You know?
Is it true that Italy, there is a government giving in free houses in some small towns at $1 per house?
Yeah, it is true.
So that you can operate and...
It is true. It is true. It is true, but it's not places that you would want to own that house. it's like Sicily where, you know, let's say...
No, but can there be an arrangement where we buy those houses for $1 and...
No. I don't think so. But I think you can get very reasonably nice houses at, you know, let's say... the cost of a house in, let's say, outside Bombay city limits. So you can get a house there which is, you know, at 120,000, 130,000 euros, and, you know, you can make 7-8% yield.
How do you use the very important and valuable data of the customer's behavior? Like, for example, Pondicherry is receiving great response, or Goa is receiving fantastic response. When you see that data, what do you do about it?
So we have two things. One is we make certain decisions based on data. So if we're making decision based on data, we expect the destination to already have volume. So which means that it has to be an established destination, and then we will work backwards with the data, and, you know, because, and the asset usually will already be created. Recently in India, we've had exciting opportunities where it's a blank canvas, which means that, you know, it's a plot of land that's beautiful, mind-blowing, land price which is cheap, a destination that's not discovered. But we believe that, you know, with a marquee property there and with the right kind of promotion and the OTA distribution, etc., that property will perform once it's completed.
So Roshan, every business has blind spots. What is the blind spots in the business that you're doing?
I think the blind spot for us is the budget segment. So the question for, we operate at the upper end of the segment, and, you know, there's always a risk that, you know, in a country like India, which is a young country with many young people coming into the earning stage of their life, that they may start the relationship with some other competitor of ours at the budget segment. And then if they're happy, they will continue to transition that relationship as they become wealthier. So the question for us is that, you know, is that is our blind spot? Do we go aggressively into the budget end of the segment, into budget vacation homes, budget properties, and run them differently? Or do we enter even lower than that, which means that the fractional or the timeshare kind of segment, which means that, you know, if you are a recently met a developer in Bombay who's like, okay, you know, there are young people who are making salaries of 25,000-30,000 rupees, and they want four of them to get together and buy a home. So they may be players who are coming in even below that ticket size. And so do we indulge in that? Or if they don't indulge in that, is there somebody else who suddenly may go and get 1 million young millennials as his customer? And then, you know, if he's doing a good job of giving them yield, et cetera, can he continue to transition that relationship as they become wealthier, leaving us out of the picture? You know?
How difficult was it to tie up with other operators like Airbnb, Hotels.com, Bookings.com, MakeMyTrip.com,
Clear.com? Very easy. It was a five-minute conversation.
I'm sure you must have realized that there are people who are taking houses on rent and then tying up with Airbnb and managing it like a hotel property. So this is happening a lot these days in tourism places like Pondicherry, Goa, Pune, all of these places.
Yeah.
How do you counter that kind of competition?
So there is...
Because they are using the same tools that Tripvillas is using,
correct,
the platform of Airbnb.
Correct. So one is that we have, of course, diversified base. So these guys, that use of capital can only go to, like, can be done at a small scale. What I mean by that is, I'm a family living in Coorg, and I have five people whose homes I can rent, and I can, but I'm limited by how much rent can I pay out, and how much demand can I generate to fill those rooms, etc. So we don't see them as being long-term. So we have an offering for them where they use our booking engine, they use our distribution, etc., and we're happy with that. We don't intend to play in that segment. And we don't feel that this model of paying rent and leasing from the owner is the long-term model, because we see at the end of the day, the owner wants to have the flexibility to use his home whenever he wants to come there.
Coming back to Tripvillas, what is your valuation game?
So the valuation game, ultimately, everyone operates on a similar benchmark.
What's your plans to dilute?
Our plans to dilute is, for us as a Singaporean company, the only stock exchange in that part of the world which is receptive to companies going IPO is ASX, which is the Australian Stock Exchange. You know, typically there you can raise about 30 to 50 million US, and you can go public at 150.
When do you plan to time it?
So for us, the question is whether we do it in 2020 or 2019. This is the years.
You're already working on it?
We've already had some roadshows with them. We've already had initial conversations. They are very actively coming to, you know.
What companies. Is the market sentiment for this kind of business models in international stock markets?
It's very healthy. So if you look at recently, so there was a larger Australian business called Mantra, which was already listed on the ASX, which got acquired for $2 billion by Accor. So the Australian market, for instance, already understands the...
So are there bigger players trying to flirt with you at the moment?
I think everyone is. So, I mean, ours is a unique business, which is travel and tourism, where you have people at all parts of the spectrum. So you have management companies like Marriott, Macor, et cetera, who feel, oh, this is a management business. You have the OTAs who want to control supply and so say that, you know, I want to control the guy who controls the supply. And then you have the alternate players like an Airbnb, et cetera, who are saying that, hey, I want to get into the organized part of this business as opposed to just the disorganized part. And so maybe this is a good fit. So at the end of the day, it's flirting. Everyone has dinner and everyone...
Any message to the people who listen to this interview and try to flirt more with you?
No messages. I think they all know me, and the general thing is the same. I mean, you know, we can have conversations, etc. Ultimately, you know, from our side, there's a quick decision-making process, and ultimately, you know, it's only number of zeros that makes.
So that is the message. You're quickly going to decide on this.
Yeah, for us, no is very quick. So we've historically said no in matter of seconds. So usually we don't keep people waiting.
Fantastic. So Roshan Dsilva for Tripvillas. Friends, I have the privilege of interacting with him on a very regular basis. A brilliant young gentleman in his young 40s, I'm sure. He's going to create milestones in the business model that he's operating on, and we'll be hearing a lot about Tripvillas in this coming years, not only in India, but globally also. So the house is open for 5 questions. So we can get going to the next session. 5 questions and real quick. Short ones, not statements, not long paragraphs, just statements. Yes, Nitin.
Yeah. So I just wanted to ask that Singapore government took the initiative and took, you know, equity in this. So what was the stage? Was it in the initial stage, and how much yield they got, and how open you are for the next equity to be given out? Thank you.
He is flirting you here only.
So they came in at the very beginning of the company, in the sense that I had started the business and I was the only shareholder in the initial part of the business. They came in, so I incorporated the business in 2010. They came in 2012 as part of the first external capital we took. And post that round, we've never taken any additional capital. We've always maintained the same shareholding pattern, and nobody has put in, you know, we've never had to take additional capital post that. So, you know, I mean, so for us, diluting now is a function of, you know, is growing visibility, which means that, you know, if we go public, you know, et cetera, that's very attractive for us.
He has got the best investor. Now he'll wait for the rising valuation game. Sidhu.
Good evening, sir. So do you create any monthly revenue for the homeowners, or it is like case to case, as in when the villa is booked, you offer some commission to them?
Eventually it becomes monthly income.
Okay.
So it is paid out to the villa owners on a monthly basis. We know that we cannot sustain the relationship if there is no income in 1 month.
But there's no guaranteed...
It's not guaranteed, no. Okay. We don't start the relationship by trying to short circuit the merit by saying that I'm going to bribe you. Okay. We don't do that. But at the end of the day, we are very clear that if he's not getting income every month, that relationship is not going to last. So it has to be a regular monthly income.
So there is a flip side and there is an upside. Just because it is revenue share, there is an advantage that the villa owner can get more also at times, and it becomes like a business model. And every year, I think the revenue on an average increases by 8 to 12%.
Yeah, you can expect in real estate, yield is always going to link to inflation.
Okay, so it's at least
8%. So depending on the inflation in that country, you will get yield that trends towards that.
So it grows in a compounded format.
The capital value grows in a compounded format. Here you're taking yield out. So the capital and the yield is linked to the capital value. So in that sense, the yield is going faster than it.
So on the original number, your percentages become from 3% to 6%, 7%.
Because what happens
looks more attractive to the buyer.
That is looking at it from an Indian angle, because in India, you have multiple forces, right? You have the currency which is depreciating, and you have capital value automatically has to appreciate because the cost of rebuilding that asset is going
gone high. Yes, Rohit.
Yeah. Roshan, today everybody is talking about the valuation game, and there's a mad rush. And we see many companies are just burning money year on year. So do you think this model is sustainable, or it is going to burst sometime in future?
The easy answer is saying that it's burst, but that's not the right answer.
Oh, so give us the right answer.
The right answer is that the bubble can only burst if the money dries up. Now, if you're coming into a country like India, and you're coming with a backer like SoftBank, that money is not going to dry up. So the amount of money that you can spend, because you know you have 100 million consuming Indians, even if you want to give them $10 of subsidy every year to shift transactions to you, you're spending $1 billion. Over 2-3 years period, you're spending $2-3 billion. This is nothing for SoftBank in a particular segment. So that party will not stop for the person who's got $3 billion behind him. The question is whether the person putting in the 2-3 billion will see return on capital, and will he see for the risk that he's taking, will he see multiplication of that money? I don't believe so. But I don't expect that the guy spending 3 billion is going to go bust.
Fantastic. Shweta, that's the last question for this session.
So Roshan, this is rather a personal question. So your story is quite inspiring, and I'm very happy that I'm here. I just wanted to ask you that entire story, it seems like a very smooth sail. Was there a day when you thought, okay, what am I doing? Will I be able to do it? Or I mean, was there a day where you hit a like a wall, and then what did you do about it?
So what happens is that I think that ultimately it's what you like doing, right? Because each person's personality is different. My personality is that ideally I am not that much. I'm not I would say Rajesh is the typical entrepreneur in the sense that, you know, is the person who can supercharge his team, keep motivating them, etc., etc. I am more of an analyst and a person who designs and looks at numbers, and that's my core personality. So for me, it is, you know, I of course work very closely with my sales team, etc. But there are some parts of the business I enjoy and some parts I don't enjoy. So I have tried to, you know, cultivate people around me who do those kind of things. So some days, if I'm put into this side of things, I may feel that, hey, look, I'm not really enjoying this. Yeah.
So thank you, Roshan. That was excellent, interesting, inspiring. I would like to request Nagu Chidambaram to come up on the stage and give a plaque. I would like to Sir Ravi Salunke to come up on board. And please hand over the mug to Roshan. Roshan, that was good. Thank you.